Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It is my privilege to speak on the occasion of educational meet of Georgian Alumni Association of my alma mater, KGMU, Lucknow. Today I will speak on dental amalgam phase down, marching towards mercury-free dentistry. So, the global concern regarding mercury is its long-range atmospheric transport, its persistence in environment due to humans, which has been introduced, its ability to bioaccumulate, and the negative effects that it causes on the environment and the human health. According to United Nations Environmental Programme, 340 tons of mercury is used in dentistry. That is about 1/10 of world's annual mercury consumption. Out of this, India uses about 65 tons. And out of 65 tons, 17 tons are actually thrown out as non-contact amalgam. Non-contact means it is non-infective. And in the US, the dentists are the largest users of mercury. So dental mercury's toxic journey back into the environment. In this, we have the mercury that contaminates the trash, which is sent into the incinerator. From the incinerator, we all know it will go back into the air. And if it goes into the landfill, it goes into the ground. And in this, we have the remnants which remain in the amalgam capsule. Any excess material which has been mixed and fraturated, or even when we are doing a restoration, we have to remove the excess amalgam because a restoration has to conform to the anatomy of the tooth. And so all this material, if it is sent into the landfill, we are actually sending it back into our land, into the ground. As far as water is concerned, the filtration system only captures a small percent of amalgam, when we are working on a dental chair. And most of it goes into the drain and sewage as sludge. Mercury vapor is released in the air. How does that happen? When we are using amalgam and the last step is polishing of amalgam restorations, the burr, that is the equipment which is used to polish this material, it creates heat and therefore mercury is vapor is generated. Also, when we are removing amalgam, then dental drill, lots of you must have had restorations done in your teeth, and this also creates enormous amount of mercury vapor, which is then released into the air. So what are the interventions at different levels? That is our concern at global, at national and individual level. So this, to limit the mercury, this was done through the Minamata Convention in 2013. And 140 countries agreed in the Minamata Convention on mercury by UNEP. And this treaty was signed on 10th October 2013. India signed this convention on 30th September 2014, and it was ratified on 18th June 2018. So amalgam actually classifies as a mercury added products. That is, it is intentionally here in this mercury is added. So in this convention, all mercury added products, they were subjected to phase out. As you all know, all thermometers have been replaced in all hospitals, but the only exception was dental amalgam, for which it was agreed to phase it down. So the key partners in phasing down the use of amalgam, they are the dental manufacturers, third-party payment systems. In this, the insurance policies and programs that favor the use of quality alternatives to dental amalgam, they are being encouraged. Then we have the policy makers like WHO, International Association for Dental Research, FDI, UNEP, and as well as national health authorities, like mainly the Ministry of Health and Environment, Government of India. They are the key partners in this Minamata Convention. So what needs to be done? The prime objectives are the measures to be taken by a party. The party here would mean any institution or a dental college, university, to phase down the use of dental amalgam. And this should include two or more measures from the following list. First is the disease prevention. Second is research on alternative restorative materials. Here any dissertation or thesis by a postgraduate students or even intramural research by faculty, any faculty can be taken up. Then third is education and training. This entails organization of conferences, lectures, and publications. Then we have the financial incentives and, of course, the best management practices. I'm sorry. So the cabinet nod, as I mentioned before, to ratify the Minamata Convention on Mercury. This happened on 7th of February 2018. And this was a signal to begin the phase down of amalgam in our country. And it was also decided that by 2032, mining of mercury will be banned. And as a dental fraternity, all of us should be prepared by then for a 100% phase out. So at the national level, who are the stakeholders? We have professional organizations like Indian Association of Conservative Dentistry and Endodontics. Also, we have certain NGOs who are working in this field, like the Toxic Links. Then we have regulatory bodies for dentistry. It is the Dental Council of India. Then we have the dental service and education providers, institutions and universities like KGMU, Maulana Azad Institute of Dental Sciences. And then we have the policy makers and national health authorities. As I mentioned before, they are mainly two who work in this direction. They are the Ministry of Environment and Ministry of Health, Government of India. So the first objective of Minamata Convention is disease prevention and health promotion. In this, dental caries prevention and oral health promotion is foremost. As the saying goes, prevention is worth a pound of, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. So setting up of national objectives at minimizing mercury use and production of mercury added compounds amalgam will help us in achieving this objective. At policymaker level, there has to be an increased emphasis in the health system on preventive care, risk assessment, and surveillance. Also, implementation of national level prevention for dental caries through National Oral Health, NOPH, National Oral Health Program, is a must. At our level, that is the treatment provider level, prevention-based model of oral healthcare should be encouraged, and practicing minimal intervention dentistry also is a very important fact, which we all should practice. The second objective of Minamata Convention is dental restorative material research. And in this, there is promotion of research and development of quality mercury-free materials for research purpose for dental restoration. Also included in this is a clinical assessment report of existing alternatives to amalgam, and long-term clinical follow-ups, they should be done. And publications of research reports at regional as well as it can be national, international level for information of all. That is also an extremely important fact. The third objective of Minamata Convention is education and encouraging representative professional organizations. For us, for dental fraternity, we all know it is the Indian Dental Association and Indian Association of Conservative Dentistry and Endodontics, and dental schools and colleges. They should educate and train dental professionals and students on the use of mercury-free dental restoration alternatives, on promoting and as well as promoting best management practices. Promoting the use of cost-effective and clinically effective mercury-free alternatives for dental restoration also comes under this objective of Minamata Convention. Then we come to the fourth objective of Minamata Convention, which is the financial incentive. And insurance policy, I mentioned this before also, and programs, they are to be encouraged that favor the use of quality alternatives to dental amalgam. And we also need to collaborate with the dental suppliers to ensure adequate supply of mercury-free dental restorations. The fifth and most important objective of Minamata Convention is best management practices. And this is used for to promote best environmental practices in dental facilities. This is to reduce the release of mercury and mercury compounds into land and landfills and water bodies and also air. And the standard amalgam separator, this is very important equipment which should be present in most all dental offices and institutions. We have to ensure safe handling practices, effective waste management, and appropriate disposal of material. So India's efforts is, that is the Bureau of Indian Standard. This is, the Indian standard is identical with ISO 2004. That is International Organization of Standardization. That was dentistry, mercury and alloys for dental amalgam. And this was adopted by Bureau of Indian Standards in March 2012. So then came the revised ISO 2015 that specifies the revised requirements and test methods for dental amalgam alloys and mercury together with the requirements for packaging and marking. In this, bulk dental mercury is no longer used and it is not within the scope of this international standard. And provisions for packaging and markings required for mercury safety warnings and precautions, everything has been now revised. So India's efforts is currently National Oral Health Program, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, India is formulating the detailed guidelines for dental amalgam phase down in association with major dental institutes of India. So intervention at individual level, that is what we can do as individual practitioners of dentistry. We can use, as I said before, dental amalgam separator in dental offices and facilities is very important. You can see here a picture of an amalgam separator that was installed in Department of Conservative Dentistry and Endodontics, Maulana Azad Institute of Dental Sciences, where I work. And the function is that it collects wastewater from the vacuum, and depending on the timing of your clinic, if it is a private clinic or your institutional timing, it is timed, it can be for 10 to 12 hours. Ultimately, it separates the water and amalgam, The amalgam is then collected for disposal. Also, we have to follow the recommended mercury hygiene measures, and the aim is to minimize the exposure to mercury, which should be below 10 microgram per cubic meter of air. Normal permissible limit in an operatory at the moment is 50 micrograms per cubic meter of air. We also have to keep the mercury out of solid waste and wastewater streams and incinerators. And use of dental amalgam is only in predisposed encapsulated form. You can see here an amalgam capsule which contains alloy powder and mercury, which is then mixed or triturated to get amalgam, which is then used to restore a tooth, a cavity. This is a picture of amalgam separator. And as we all know by now, it is used for filtration. It filters out the mercury, separates the amalgam, which is then collected for disposal. Then also we have to keep into consideration optimal use of mercury containing fillings, segregation and storage of mercury mercury waste which is generated. Then we have the spill management training we all must undergo. You can see here a mercury spill kit that contains a PPE. In today's time, everybody is using PPE. But as far as this particular kit is concerned, it should have a mask as well as a vinyl glove. Then we have waste mercury bottle where the spilled mercury is collected. For manipulation, we have common instruments like the spatula, scoop, brush, and syringe for handling mercury. Then we have the absorption system and the instruction sheet that you can see here. This is for 8 instructions how to use, how to manage a mercury spill if it occurs in your office. Then how to remove old amalgam fillings. This smart technique is used. It means safe mercury amalgam removal technique. Here a high volume suction is used. And removal of amalgam restoration, it is done in chunks, and so that to minimize vapor generation, and use of PPE is mandatory for this. Then segregation and storage of amalgam. We have, you can see, a bottle which is used for collecting non-contact amalgam. Non-contact means it is the scrap which is non-infected. Then we have the empty, these are the capsules which are also stored. Then these are the traps which are used to contain amalgam, large pieces of amalgam. And this is the vacuum which is connected to the trap. And it allows the water to go, and it filters out the amalgam. It remains within this trap. And also leaking or unusable amalgam capsules also have to be separated out and segregated. So how do we actually design a dental office? Firstly, there should be proper ventilation. Second, in any air conditioned clinics, filters are regularly, they should be replaced. Then a mercury vapor analyzer, this should be present so that we can minimize the mercury level to about 10 micrograms per cubic meter. Then all the floors of the clinic, they should be non-carpeted and non-absorbent. And before we leave our clinic, our professional clothings, they should be left in the clinic itself. So the question is how to make mercury history. These are few points. There should be restricted use of amalgam only for academic purposes. That is in the phase down. This is the period which we are in at the moment. Then best management, mercury management practices And this should be reviewed by a designated mercury officer every 6 months. This applies to an institution, but this can also be done in private clinics. Somebody has to be trained and do this on regular basis. Then we have extensive research on mercury-free restorative materials. They should be done. And smart removal of amalgam, old amalgam restorations. There has to be a ban on new amalgam restorations in children and pregnant women. And amalgam separators, that is a must for all of us. So this is a take home that a number of guidelines, they support the features, they have been presented internationally. And of course, they have been also been adopted by our country. And India as such, we need to briskly walk in the direction of phasing down of mercury consumption in dentistry. Then only we'll be able to fulfill the Minamata Convention of phase out of mercury by possibly by 2032. Thank you so much.